Penguin Random House Audio presents The Point of It All, A Lifetime of Great Loves and Endeavors by Charles Krauthammer, edited by Daniel Krauthammer. Read for you by Jeremy Bobb and Daniel Krauthammer. To my wife, Robin. With extraordinary intelligence, humor, grace, and loving kindness, she has co-authored my life, of which this book is but a reflection. And to my son Daniel, whose incisive, brilliant mind has been an incredible influence and shaper of my own since he was 10 years old.
Introduction by Daniel Krauthammer. Read by Daniel Krauthammer. 1. The author and the editor of this book. Charles Krauthammer was my father. Writing that sentence in the past tense is still a shock to me, and it evokes a sadness far too deep to express in words. My father and I were very close. I feel the pain of his absence every day, as does every son who loved his father. There were 1,000 secret private things between him and me that I alone had known and that I alone will miss about the man who was my dad. But my father belonged not only to me, but to so many more. His friends, his colleagues, his readers, his viewers, the country, and indeed the world. He played a large role in the political life of this nation, and though he was far too self-effacing to say so himself, his thinking, his ideas, and his convictions shaped generations of political thinkers. For almost 4 decades, he wrote a weekly column syndicated in the Washington Post and hundreds of other newspapers around the world. He wrote essays for preeminent magazines like The New Republic, Time, and The Weekly Standard. He appeared on television to comment on the events of the day throughout his career, culminating with near-nightly appearances on Fox News' Special Report for over a decade. Policymakers and politicians in Washington read him, listened to him, and often took their lead from him. But my father did not write solely for the cognoscenti and the power brokers. He always told me that he wanted to write and speak so that anyone with intelligence and interest could grapple with and benefit from his arguments. He believed in Einstein's apocryphal dictum that if you can't explain it simply, you don't understand it well enough. That, I believe, is the root of his extraordinary popularity. He didn't talk down. He thought that unnecessary complexity and heavy-handed erudition got in the way of true insight and knowledge. You don't want to talk in highfalutin, ridiculous abstractions that nobody understands, he said. Just try to make things plain and clear. He wished to express the truths he saw in the most universal, accessible, concise, and convincing way that he could. He felt a responsibility to his readers and viewers, and beyond that, to history itself. As he put it, quote, I left psychiatry to start writing, because I felt history happening outside the examining room door. That history was being shaped by a war of ideas, and I wanted to be in the arena. Not for its own sake. I enjoy intellectual combat, but I don't live for it. I wanted to be in the arena because some things matter. Some things need to be said. Some things need to be defended. End quote. My father was not just going through the motions. He cared deeply about everything he said and everything he wrote. He knew it would play a part in the discourses that shaped real policies, affected real people, and determined the future of the country he loved. He did not take that responsibility lightly. In a 2013 interview, he described the sense of duty he felt to pursue his vocation with the highest order of integrity, saying, "You're betraying your whole life if you don't say what you think, and you don't say it honestly and bluntly." He always said what he thought, and he championed the ideas he believed in. That is why he will be missed by everyone who appreciated his arguments and insights, and that is why it was so important to me to complete this book for him, and to complete it well. His thoughts mattered. His arguments mattered. His presence in our national discourse mattered. And I hope, through this book, they will continue to matter for future generations of readers. 2. The origins of this book. This book was a long time in the making. Following the success of his lauded collection of columns and essays, Things That Matter, my father had intended to write several more books. He wished to write an original work on foreign policy, another on domestic policy, and a more personal memoir that would trace his family history as well as his own. But in addition to these ambitions for new writing projects, he felt an ever-present desire to publish another collection. There were many more columns and essays of his that he wanted the world to see, pieces that had not fit with the thematic organization of Things That Matter, pieces he had written in the time since, and pieces that, frankly, he had felt were too personal to include the first time round. These columns and essays needed a home. In 2016, my father decided he would move ahead simultaneously toward completion of that new collection and an original work on foreign policy. He put together an initial selection of columns and began organizing them into thematic chapters. Meanwhile, he began writing an extended essay for the work on foreign policy and collecting pieces he planned to draw on in composing the other entries for that book. It was at this juncture that a health crisis struck my father. In August of 2017, he underwent surgery in Washington, D.C. to remove a cancerous tumor from his abdomen. The surgery was thought to have been a success in removing the cancer, but a cascade of secondary complications followed. My father spent many months in the ICU, and then many more at a specialized catastrophic care hospital in Atlanta, Georgia. Great progress was made in the following months toward restoring him to health. There were extraordinary difficulties and many setbacks, but the light at the end of the tunnel was clearly visible, and we were slowly making our way. Though his energies were intensely focused on his physical recovery, my father devoted what time and attention he could while he was in the hospital to working on the book. My mother and I were by his side for the entire 10 months of that hospital sojourn. During that time, I concocted an array of digital and physical displays of all shapes and sizes, with assistance from our favorite hospital staff friends, who helped me rewire our TVs and commandeer the building's Wi-Fi, to build as practical a workplace for him as we could achieve amongst all the medical gadgets and gizmos. These helter-skelter arrangements worked well enough for my father to get by, and there were times when we were able to talk over his plans and ideas together, and I could help him execute some of the details. However, this progress, with his work and with his health, did not last. In May of 2018, the news was broken to us that my father's recovery would not be successful. The cancer had returned with a vengeance. It moved aggressively and relentlessly. Just 4 weeks later, my father died. As the end was approaching, my father handed responsibility for finishing the book to me. The last time we spoke about it, he turned to me and said, "If it's not worthy, don't publish it." I made him an oath, and I have taken it more seriously than any other promise I have ever made in my life. I can only hope that my efforts have done justice to the great legacy of the man I loved. 3. The organization and methodology of this book. This book is, first and foremost, my father's. Every word in it, save this introduction and the final entry, my eulogy for him, is his. Its conception and initial construction were his, as are every thought and argument it conveys. When my father handed the reins to me, he had already chosen the majority of the columns that still constitute this book, and set aside many more pieces for further consideration, which in turn constitute the majority of the additions made to his initial composition. There was still much work to do, however, when I took over the project in full after his passing. I read through every runner-up piece my father had considered, and hundreds more, as many as I possibly could in the time I had to complete the project. I added columns, removed some, replaced others, and rearranged their order in many places to make his arguments flow in what I believe he would see as the most natural and logical progression. In this book, what began as two separate projects became one. The first three sections of the book are essentially the collection he envisioned. Divided into 15 thematic chapters, they cover a wide range of his views on the whole gamut of topics, progressing from the ideas he felt closest to in his soul, to his thoughts on society at large, and finally to the political questions of the day. What began as my father's original project on foreign policy and the international order has become part four of this book, Competing Visions: America's Role and the Course of World History. In it is the long essay that was to form the core of that work and now anchors this book, The Authoritarian Temptation. It draws the central themes of the book to a summation point and leaves the reader to ponder what my father believed to be the most important questions and challenges facing the politics of our future. It is the one new piece in this collection never before seen by the public. Most of the articles in this collection are columns and short essays, but there are several longer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.